John, thank you very, very much. Thank you. Thank you all for being here. Thank you very much, and it's a privilege for me to be able to share a few words here on what is, by necessity, a quick trip, and I apologize for that, and I am grateful for your steadfast efforts to get us over the finish line. Todd and I have worked together for a long time now, going all the way back to my time in the Senate, and I appreciate, Todd, all the work that you and the entire delegation have been doing. I just had a chance to meet with them. And I thank you not just for your work here in Lima, but for your work all around the world. I also want to thank a few other people who are here today, if I may. Our terrific Ambassador of Peru, Brian Nichols, the Executive Secretary of the UN FCCC, Cristiana Figueres, Environment Minister of Peru, Manuel Vulgar Vida, and all of the other diplomats, scientists, experts, activists, all of you, concerned citizens who are hard at work, in order to make sure that we get this right. I'm also delighted to say that because of all that hard work, I understand we now have enough pledges from the international community to meet and exceed the initial Climate Green Fund target of $10 billion. And the United States is very proud to be contributing $3 billion. We are grateful for the announcement of countries like Australia, Belgium, Colombia, and Peru that they have made in recent days to help get us over the hurdle. All of this will help to ensure that this fund can succeed in helping the most overburdened nations of the world to do more to be able to respond to climate change. And finally, I want to thank Peru for hosting the COP20. A critical stepping stone to the agreement that we must reach in Paris next year. Now, for Peru, climate change is personal. It will determine whether future generations will know Peru as we know it today, as we have known it, or whether today's treasures are confined to history. Think about it. Peru is home to 70% of the world's tropical glaciers, to nearly all of the world's major ecosystems, and to more fish species than any other country on Earth. But already, almost half the volume of many glaciers has melted away just in the last 30 years or so. Ecosystems are visibly being destroyed before our eyes, and fisheries are threatened. So this is not just a fight by Peru. It is a fight for Peru. And this is not just another policy issue. Measured against the array of global threats that we face today, and there are many, terrorism, extremism, epidemics, poverty, nuclear proliferation, all challenges that know no borders, climate change absolutely ranks up there equal with all of them. And I challenge anyone who has thought about the science or listened, actually listened carefully to national security experts tell us that these dangers are real, I challenge them to tell us otherwise, and to show us otherwise. I might add that we have, as Todd mentioned, a distinguished former Vice President of the United States and Nobel Prize winner who was a leader with all of us on this issue, but the first among equals, believe me, in his passion and commitment to this. And I've often heard him reciting the numbers of studies and the amazing amount of evidence that has been tallied up versus the paucity of a few, usually industry paid for, false analyses that try to suggest otherwise. And while no one here believes that a global climate agreement is going to be the silver bullet that eliminates this threat, I think everybody here can agree that we certainly won't eliminate it without an agreement. Now, I know that everybody in this room is committed, all of us. But I think when you're among the committed, you have a responsibility to be particularly candid. It seems that every time I speak at an event about climate change, someone introducing me, as Todd did today, said, John Kerry's been to every major gathering since Rio. It's true. But I'll tell you something. That's kind of troubling